is live coverage of this game between the Soviet Union and Canada. Whenever these two nations meet in hockey, it is a major attraction, and this game should be no exception. Although Canada cannot win the gold medal, Canada can deprive the Soviet Union from winning the gold, and Canada at the same time can pick up the second place silver medal. The only loss on the Canadian record, that 5-4 setback at the hands of Team Sweden, and Sweden's only loss, a somewhat controversial 3-2 setback at the hands of the Soviet Union. That was the game where the additional puck mysteriously appeared on the ice right in front of the Soviet goal with some 30 seconds remaining. The Swedes thought they had scored, but it was waved off because of two pucks being on the ice at the time. Tom Webster, who coached the Windsor Spitfires in the Ontario Hockey League last year and is their coach again this year, as a matter of fact, has been there for several years now, and he's the head coach of this Canadian junior team. Stefan Fassette has been in goal for all but one of the games. The backup for Canada, Gus Morschauser, was in goal for their victory over Germany. And in goal for the Soviet Union, Alexei Ivashkin, who was a goaltender with the team, mainly in a backup capacity in last year's tournament in Moscow. Goaltending is always a key in this World Junior Tournament. Teams must rely on their goaltenders to come up with big saves, perhaps even to win a couple of games. Steve Piotrowski of the United States, and this is a real break for Canada, is the referee tonight, and the linesmen are Roos Peter of Czechoslovakia and Rautavaari of Finland. Most times the Soviet Union would exercise their veto if a North American official is nominated for a game involving Canada. Obviously he has to be from the United States, and the Soviet Union doesn't go along with it, but in this case they have. Play in the Soviet zone. The Soviets move it up to the line. Mogilny runs into a check, but it's brought up by Gordiuk, and it's fired down the ice, and going back after it is Pavel Bure. He's the speedy 17-year-old. For Mogilny, a quick shot. He has got a quick release, and he had it on target. Fassette came up with the save.
Well, again, Fassette's been outstanding. You alluded to it earlier, Don. It's big goaltending that always wins in crucial playoffs or in a tournament like this, and he's been great. But that line that we see out here, that Bure that you refer to, he's got speed. I'll tell you what, he can crank him up and down. I'm not sure there's anybody in this tournament as quick as he is.
Robert Cherenkov is the coach of this Soviet squad. They must win to capture the gold medal. A loss would move them back into the bronze medal position. You think that just last evening they had an opportunity, or two nights ago they had an opportunity to go through the tournament undefeated, but they were upset by Czechoslovakia by a score of 5-3. Play in the Soviet zone. Here's a shot by Leach, a backhand shot. Ivashkin makes the save. Leach continuing the battle in the corner for that loose puck with Zubov. It comes up to the line, and Sidorov deflects it down the ice into the Canadian zone with captain Eric Desjardins going back after it. Desjardins looking up on the right side for Leach, too far for him. This will produce an icing call against Team Canada with 18:41 remaining in the opening period.
From an emotional standpoint, that was good for the Canadian team. They got in there, they found out they can penetrate a little bit. Leach got off a couple of good shots. I know one of their objectives is to try to get it high on the goaltender. They're going to penetrate, they're going to go to the net. This is it. Today's the day. You know, and as we said earlier, it doesn't matter if it's a gold medal or not. They're playing the Soviets, and they want to beat them. You can be sure of that.
Well, the Canadian team was so enthused after its victory 4-3 with that late goal by Castles last night over Finland, and then they had to hope for a victory by Team USA over Sweden today to be in the chase for the gold medal. And while the United States team perhaps had its best competition of the tournament, they were not up to the caliber of the Swedes, and they dropped a 3-1 decision. Ivanov touches it in his own zone. An icing call. That was Martin Jelena chasing him down in that Soviet zone.
Well, Martin Jelena, number 7, as the viewers can see, he's been hurt for most of this tournament. He really hasn't been himself. A number 1 draft choice. He's the guy that was traded, as a matter of fact, to Edmonton for Gretzky from L.A. He can score. He's only got two assists, and only because he's hurt, because you'd see him around the net a lot, getting a lot of points.
He might go into the trivia books as the player who was traded for the man who owned him.
You stung a lot of people on that question, Don. Stung a lot of people here.
Wayne Gretzky, of course, the owner of the Hull Olympics, the team that Jelena played for. Long shot. Goes back of the net. The battle continues there. The Soviets trying to get it out front. And going into the corner after it is Racine. Racine dumps it down the ice. A race for the loose puck. Ivanov back for the Soviets. He hammers it around on the boards. Shannon tried to keep it in. He was unsuccessful, and the Soviets bring it out into the neutral zone. At the line, Gordiev manages to slide it off to Gamolyakov. His shot goes off a leg to the corner. Gamolyakov and Okusta, along with Gordiev, form the biggest line in the tournament. All three are over 200 pounds. Gamolyakov is a big forward. He's 6'3", 220 pounds. Smith with a long shot through traffic. It did not get to the goal as a couple of players were in front of the net and it hit them. Now it's brought back down the ice by Vygotsky. His shot goes over the glass and out of play. 17-18 is the time remaining in a still scoreless opening period. Play just underway. Jeff Smith up along the boards for Lowen. He gets it to Savage, down the ice to McIntyre. Sorokin takes him in against the boards. And Panafilenkov has the puck for the Soviet Union. He was looking for Slavikov, intercepted by McIntyre in across the line. He takes a hit, and the loose puck is brought back by the Soviets. Mikovsky flips it into the corner. Lowen really cranked the Soviet player Godiniuk and sent him flying in the neutral zone. Back comes Canada, trying to make it a 3-on-2, but they opt for a change in lines as Lowen is taken out of the play, back of the Soviet goal, and Godinuk knocks it out into the center ice area. He was sent flying in the corner. Here's Mogilny with a shot. It just deflects wide. Some good bumping early in this game. Canada has dished out a couple of good body checks. Sheldon Kennedy almost took that lead pass and broke in. To Brenda Moore, he runs into a check from Udin. And the Soviet Union takes over at center ice. Lambert knocks down a shot and dumps it back out to the neutral zone. We played 4 minutes of this first period. Sheldon Kennedy. Pass ahead to Brenda. The net. No one was there. Murphy in the corner, looking for Brenda Moore. Brenda Moore trying to go to the net, gets a shot away finally as that puck bounced. But the goaltender of Ashkin was there to make the save. Mogilny in across the line. Good move, getting into the slot. A shot saved by Fassette. The rebound in front, and it's picked up by Lambert, who starts back for Canada. What an excellent move by Mogilny. That's why he was chosen the top player in this tournament a year ago. Nobody at the point as Canada attempts to apply some pressure. And coming out of his net is Stefan Fassette as he clears it up in the wing to Ricci. It's whistled down on a two-line pass.
Well, it was an exciting play, and as you pointed out, he's not an exciting player, but that Fassette is out there. I've said so much about him. These are the kind of tournaments for players. Watch him go into the middle now. Keeps a man with him, and he gets it. He's going off stride, but look at where Fassette is. He's out on top of the and scrambles to get that puck as Fedorov, who's very, very good with the puck and a great quarterback, is right there.
From the faceoff, a shot right on, the save, the rebound, and the whistle had gone as Fassette came up with another big save.
Well, I don't know how many times we've said his name, Don, in this tournament, but there it is. He's out there. He makes the puck hit him. By the way, he comes out and blocks it. He was there for the second shot. And as you've said, every tournament we've been at, it's always been a goaltender that's helped win this tournament for one of the teams.
From the faceoff, it's Racine playing it around on the boards. Canada trying to get it out of the zone. Leach battling there. Puck goes loose, and Khristich for the Soviet Union drops it off in the corner. Gordiev, backhand shot, and that went wide. Dumped down the ice and racing back after it is Ivanov, and as he touches it, it's an icing call against Team Canada. Brian?
All right, Don, coming up at the end of the first period, the coach, Don Cherry, will join us live from Toronto. We'll have highlights of Canada-Finland, that big win last night. We'll take you on a tour of this very interesting city, and we will talk with the head coach of Team Sweden. Sweden with a good shot at winning the gold. That is if Canada beats the Soviets here tonight. Don?
Yes, this is a very interesting city indeed, and I think a lot of people have a misconception about weather in this part of the world. It's been much milder than I anticipated. The last couple of days have been a little cool, but for most of our stay here, the mercury has hovered around the freezing mark.
We warmed up, as a matter of fact, some of us.
Back at the line, Sorokin fires it into the corner. Piotrowski is the referee tonight. He's from the United States. Okusta, big strong winger, trying to get it out front. He was tied up, and Shannon brings it back for Canada. He shoots it in. Gadinyuk going back of the net, playing it around in the boards. Jelena raced in to get the puck. Jelena centering, nobody there, back to Desjardins. He fires it wide. Gadinyuk will try again to Sorokin. He just bangs it around in the boards, and Sidorov gets it out into the center ice area. Okusta lost control of the puck, and Jeff Smith, in attempting to clear, put it into the Canadian bench, out of play with 13:55 left in the period. Coach Tom Webster has done some juggling of his lines for this game. He has Savage out there with Lowen and McIntyre. This is a new combination. Brought out by Lambert. Lambert dumps it in. Lowen racing in along with McIntyre. McIntyre back of the net for Lowen. He returns the pass to him. McIntyre for Lowen. Lowen having a little trouble controlling it. And the Soviets, who like to keep a man up high in their defensive zone, knock it out into the neutral zone.
They certainly do. We talk about going from defense to offense. If they see they're going to get a puck, the forwards leave right away.
Udine's shot is blocked by Lambert. And Foster for Canada was looking for McIntyre. The Soviets' Bykovsky deflects it all the way back into his own zone. Panfilenkov now for the Soviet Union into the center ice area. Sypikov leaves it there for Panfilenkov. Takes the shot, and Fassett moved across with him to cut down the angle. Seemed as though Panfilenkov had all sorts of time, but they did a good job of cutting down that angle. Ivanov shot is blocked before it gets to the net. Sheldon Kennedy for Canada trying to go around the defenseman, and the puck goes back to the net. Ivanov has it. He plays it off the boards and down the ice. And this is going to produce an icing call against the Soviet Union. 12:39 is the time remaining in this first period. Canada started with a 7-1 win over Norway, the only game they did not play in this tournament in the Sullivan Arena. Then they beat West Germany 7-4. Their first big test, a game we televised, 5-1 over the USA. But then that disastrous loss, 5-4 to Sweden, that has deprived them of a gold medal. They tied the Czechs at 2 with a late goal, and they beat Finland 4-3 with a late goal. In that game against Sweden, Canada was ahead by a score of 2-0. Late in the game, they had a 4-3 lead. With about 3 minutes left, Sweden tied it, and Sweden scored the winning goal with just 27 seconds left in the game. And now, if Canada should lose, Sweden can win the goal. Saved by Fassett as he made an excellent stop. The Soviets applying all sorts of pressure, and again, that was Mogilny who had the opportunity to put the Soviets on the board.
Selfish move on the part of Mogilny. No question. We're going to see now. We lose the puck now. The puck is trying to be cleared, and the defenseman keeps it in. Throws it right back up with the Canadians, and now here's Mogilny. Now over there is Bure. Say, hey, give me the puck, will ya? No, he tries to score. Very selfish move on part of Mogilny. I don't care how you look at it.
Mogilny taking a shot from the faceoff, a weak one that went wide of the net. Jeff Smith starts back for Canada. Sheldon Kennedy with a shot, and the save by goaltender Ivashkin. That's the first real test for the Soviet goaltender. Jeff Smith takes it back into the neutral zone. He has to wait for his teammates to get onside. You may notice during the course of this game that Bure, the youngest player on that Soviet squad, wears fluorescent green skate laces. Gadnyuk with a shot that bounces off a leg. Racing after it is Lambert, but Sorokin gets back there first, can't clear. Lambert maintains control, tried to center it, and it's grabbed and held by Ivashkin, the Soviet goaltender. with 11:34 remaining in the period.
The funny thing, if there's anybody that doesn't need fluorescent skate laces, because everybody in the arena knows them, and everybody on the ice, anybody that plays, is this Bure that we've talked about. Of course, Corey Foster, drafted by New Jersey, who can drill a puck off the blue line, just drill it, and you can be sure they'll be trying to get to him because he can blast a puck. Make no mistake of that.
From the faceoff, picked up by Panfilenkov, and he goes cross ice with it. Gordiuk coming in on the left side, centers it, and Panfilenkov could not reach it, and the Canadian net has knocked off its moorings as Shannon was coming back along with Semeta. And Semeta, I think, was the player who crashed into the net, taking it off its moorings.
Well, there's a possible chance now. He gets around Foster. Now what happens? That's the upper body strength that we see on these guys. And now there he goes. Great move by Semeta to take the concentration. Takes the goal post and everything else, but prevents a good opportunity. That was an example of that upper body strength of these Russians. And you know, the way they're throwing the puck around the boards, Don, we keep saying what we've learned. They do a lot. They never used to do that for all the international competition you've covered.
Vaillou takes it for Canada. Plays it up on the right side. Ahead to Ricci. Ricci in across the line, still has control of it, takes a shot, and it was blocked by Sorokin. It goes to the corner. Ricci still battling, still controlling it for Canada, for Jamie Leach now. Leach lost it along the boards, and the Soviets start back. And Palenka losing it. Here's Khristich going.
We see a possible two-on-one again, and the defenseman's got to play in the middle of it. That's a key first goal. But you'll see the good puck control now. Very, very good puck control. Stays on the puck again. The puck bounces up. Two men go over and take him, and now watch him come in. He's got a man right there, and he throws the backhand upstairs. But that's that good puck control they got. No question about that. You'll see him now come in, this good wide angle shot. He sees the man in the corner, said no. Soon as that defenseman made a commitment, he put it upstairs. 1-0 Soviets.
Panfilenkov lost control of the puck in the corner, but two Canadian players went to Panfilenkov, and Khristich picked up that loose puck and walked in. Okusta back to the point. There's a shot right on by Zubov, and Stefan Fassette gets that one between his pads and holds it for the faceoff. 10:36 remaining in this opening period. 1-0 for the Soviet Union. Khristich getting the goal. Panfilenkov the assist at 9:08.
Well, there's Tommy Webster saying, just letting the people know, at 1-0, 10 minutes does not a hockey game make, and they just can't let that get to them.
In this full house at the Sullivan Arena tonight, watching intently the Swedish national team, and there's no question about which side they are cheering for. If Canada wins, it means a gold medal for Sweden. Okusta with an excellent move. Centers it, nobody there, and Jelena starts back for Canada. Jelena working against Udine. Going back at the net, bumped in against the boards by the Soviet defenseman. Shannon has it. He tried to center it. It went off a skate. He gets it back. The Soviets along the boards move it into the center ice area. Foster waits for everybody to get back on side. Drifts it into the corner. Picked up there by Udine. He clears the zone. Savage brings it back in, but he did it with a player trapped inside the line. 9:49 is the time remaining in the period. On that offside call, Gomolyako stepped into Jelena, and he is going to draw a penalty. You'll see the hit along the boards. It was whistled down on the offside, and it's a high sticking call as Gomolyako got his stick up into the face of Martin Jelena.
After the whistle, now this Gomolyako is 6'3", 220. So, I mean, that's like getting hit by a truck, because he can move. He's a big, they report him at 220. Some of the scouts say he could be 240. I mean, think about that for a minute.
So Canada is on the power play, trailing by a goal as Desjardins fires it in. It's offside.
Well, the old specialty team action that we talk so much about in tournaments. Canada, well, those fluorescent laces that Bure wears, that you can see them in the dark. But I tell you something, those legs move so fast when he's gone, it's even hard to pick those laces up.
And he's just 18 years of age, so he has another year at this world junior level, and he'll be back in the tournament next year when it's held in Helsinki. The Soviets get an opening and fire at the length of the ice. The set is out of his net to play it up along the boards. Fedorov races in, fires a shot wide. Brinda Moore goes back of his own goal for Lambert. Lambert pokes it up along the right side for Desjardins, ahead to Brinda Moore. In across the line, looking for Kennedy. Kennedy picks it up in the corner. Kennedy for Brinda Moore. Brinda Moore drops it back now for Savage to Brinda Moore. This was the power play unit that the Canadian team used effectively last night in their 4-3 win over Finland, but against the Soviet Union, they are having some problems. Good work by the Soviets. Bure comes in across the line, then is sent flying on a good hit by Lambert. He loses his helmet in the process. Brought out by Kennedy on the right side for Savage. Savage leaves it there for Kennedy. Kennedy going for the net, gets a return pass, and he couldn't control it. Fedorov now fires a long shot. Cassette stops that, and Foster picks it up. 35 seconds remaining in the penalty to the Soviet player, Sergei Gomolyakov. Ricci is bumped in the corner by Zubov. Vykovsky battling for it. He comes up with the puck and starts back for the Soviets. 8:05 remaining in the period, just 14 seconds left in the penalty.
Their best chance wasn't even a shot on net when Kennedy brought it up and moved. Couldn't get good control of that.
Racine centering it, blocked by the Soviets, and they dump it out of the zone, and that will kill off the penalty to Gomolyakov. Foster leading the attack now for Canada. The big defenseman is stopped at the line as he bumps into Malikin. The Soviets play it around the boards and out into the center ice area. Smith gets control for Canada, looking for someone to pass to. Canada making a line change. Puck dumped in, Ivanov for the Soviet Union. Chased in there and bumped against the boards heavily by McIntyre. Now McIntyre picks it up at the line, tried to slide it across for Castles, but Castles wasn't expecting the pass, and it was behind him. Ivanov for the Soviets. On the wing for Sidorov. Sidorov going for the net. A deflection that went off a leg, and Fassett had to react quickly to that one. Sidorov again, looking out front, Ivanov with a shot, and Fassett came way out of his net to make the save. By far the best scoring opportunities of this opening period have belonged to the Soviets, and Fassett has made a number of fine saves, or the Soviets might be in front by more than the one goal advantage they enjoy.
Excellent concentration on Fassett's part.
This will be an icing call against Canada as Malikin goes back to touch it with 6:27 remaining in this opening period. The Soviets leading by one. Ryan?
All right, Don, this Saturday afternoon in Sports Weekend, a figure skating special starring Katarina Witt from East Germany. Ken Reed and I will be on hand to bring you Saturday's Men's World Cup Downhill from Lax, Switzerland. That's all coming up Saturday afternoon in Sports Weekend. It begins at 3 Eastern, noon Pacific.
And we should issue a word of warning, Brian, to Ken Reed that his job as our ski analyst might be in jeopardy with the way Sherry Bassin has taken to the slopes here in Alaska.
I fell down 1 mile.
Gordiuk centers it. Gordiuk takes a shot that goes wide. Dumped down the ice. Gomolyakov plays it back to the line. Sorokin checked along the boards. Managed to dump it in, but it's offside. We should add that the city of Alaska bid for the Olympic Games in 1994. They did not get the bid. It went to Lillehammer, Norway. But about 40 minutes outside the city of Anchorage is an outstanding ski resort, Alyaska. We had opportunity to test the slopes there. And I will say that Sherry Bassin progressed from the bunny slope. He rode the lift right to the peak and did pretty well in his first two attempts at skiing.
But you held my hand. You got to tell him that, too.
Loose puck picked up by McIntyre. He can't go anywhere with it. Gordiuk trying to move out into the slot area, and Canada breaks away with Ricci leading the attack. Ricci and McIntyre in across the line, but McIntyre was ahead of the play offside.
Wow. How much can we say about a young man, a 17-year-old, and of course, when we talk about Ricci, what you just can't say enough about the kid. And of course, Leach, who plays on the same line with him that we get a look at, he's a key man on that right side who Ricci can give the puck to, because he can blow it, I'll tell you something, just like his father.
Ricci plays with the Peterborough Petes, and Peterborough and Oshawa battling for first place in that Ontario Hockey League. Rindamore, back of the net, looking out front, still hesitates a shot, and Ivashkin managed to make the save. Rindamore couldn't find anyone to pass it to, tried the wraparound, and Ivashkin had to react quickly. Here's Bure dropping it off for Mogilny. He puts on the brakes, looking into the slot area for Fedorov. Penalty coming up here against Canada as Bure goes back of the net, trying to center it. And as Bure is sent flying and Fassette clears it to the corner, the whistle goes and the Soviets will go to the power play.
Well, he hit that net, but he, you know, that's that big line that can put a lot of pressure that we've talked about. I think what's been very, very impressive here, Don, is the way the Soviets play the boards. They dump a little bit now like we do in Canada and play the corners, play the man very, very well. And Velu now will sit out 2 minutes. And we're going to see the shorthanded team of the Canucks, and I'd be surprised, not that big line with a man advantage for the Soviets.
Bayou, a number three draft choice of the Vancouver Canucks in 1987. He plays for Three Rivers, and he goes to the penalty box. A slashing call against the Canadian defenseman at 14:43 of this opening period, and the Soviets leading by a score of 1-0.
I've been pretty impressed with this Bayou, by the way. He really plays aggressive and plays with good, strong, controlled emotion.
From the faceoff, back at the line. Sorokin fakes the shot. Over to the other side. Back to Sorokin. There's the shot. It's wide of the net. McIntyre along the boards, unable to get it out. Following up on the play, though, was Foster. He cleared the zone, but the Soviets bring it back in. Back at the line, Soviets moving it around. They try and center it, and it bounces out into the neutral zone.
You notice that good control of the puck in the offensive zone when they got it, something that the Canadians didn't have in their power play.
Bassett out of the net to play it around on the boards. Rindamore couldn't get it out. Sorokin kept it in. Desjardins tries to move it out, but the Soviets continue that pressure. Another penalty coming up here against Canada as they knock it out into the center ice area. Slashing call against Canada, and the Canadian team with 58 seconds remaining in the penalty to Bayou will be two men short as Desjardins, the team captain, goes to the box.
Well, it was a little bit of a showboat play too. There's no question he cranked him. I think Desjardins was going more for the puck. It was a bouncing puck and it was a desperation chance to get it. But he got the leg, and then, of course, the Soviet player went down to make it pretty obvious. He did one of those and dropped to the ice with one knee. And now, for 58 seconds, we're going to see this right here. Now, watching the puck come. Now it's a reaction, actually. The puck is over there. It was a reaction call after being hit. The old reaction penalties that you and I have alluded to the whole tournament.
Slashing against Desjardins at 15:45, so for 58 seconds, the Soviets will enjoy a two-man advantage. That's one of the things coaches stress in international hockey, action penalties, but not reaction penalties, because so often those reaction penalties will be called. Ricci trying to get it out, it bounces high, and finally Sheldon Kennedy clears the zone. Ricci, Racine, and Kennedy out there killing off this two-man advantage. Puck is stolen by Ricci, dumps it down the ice. Kennedy racing after it, bumping with Sorokin. Kennedy has it, looking up front. Oh, if he could have got it to Ricci. Ricci was all by himself, but Kennedy apparently did not see him, and now there's a penalty coming up here against the Soviets. But Ricci was all by himself in front of the net if Kennedy had been able to get the puck to him.
The impressive thing here is Kennedy is aggressive on the play. He's very, very aggressive. He goes to the puck. He's been there. He scored a great goal. Watch him. He stays there. Now look at Ricci out there. He can't get it over the stick. He's trying to get to him. Ricci gets in a little close and gets the puck in his skates. Because I'll tell you, if he gets a clear shot, then the Russian player come in and hit him late. But give the Canadian players credit for being aggressive and wadding the puck so hard when you're two men short.
So Khristich goes to the box, a cross-checking call at 16-18. Still 25 seconds remaining in the penalty to Vaiu, 1:27 in the penalty to Desjardins. Khristich, one of eight players on this Soviet team who were with the squad in Moscow a year ago when the Soviets won the silver medal for their second place finish.
I can't get so excited here. I'm going to lose my voice down. You'll be all alone. You might be wanting that to happen.
3:42 remaining in this opening period. 1-0. The Soviets lead Canada. Malykin to Godinyuk. He gives it back to Okusta. Okusta, good move in across the line. Okusta takes a quick shot between the legs of Racine, and Fassette had to react to that.
Boy, we've said so much about it, but he was right there, and you'll notice right in stride he let that shot go. A wrist shot in stride.
Now Canada has Vaiu back on the ice. Long shot, and that is held as Gordiuk let the blast go from the top of the circle. 54 seconds remaining in the penalty to Desjardins, 1:27 in the penalty to Khristich.
Interesting point. I don't think that Canada at the time knew that the penalty was up because they let that guy walk in. It's a story that we talk about communication. He just came out of the penalty box, and so we'll see how alert Stefan Fassette is, and right there, he lets it go, and they can let the puck go, but look at how he's got everything blocked up. Trying to go between his legs, not very fortunate, you can be sure of that. That won't happen on this kid.
Vaiu, back of his own goal. For Sheldon Kennedy. Kennedy, one of two holdovers on this Canadian team. He and Desjardins played with the gold medal champions in Moscow. Malykin, in his own zone for the Soviet Union, being watched by Ricci, forces him back. Godinyuk gives it back to Malykin. Pass into the center ice area. He was looking for Bykovsky, and this is an icing call against Team Soviet.
Well, they're going to play four aside or five aside with the goaltender for another 18 seconds, and then Canada is going to have a 33-second power play to maybe get something going. We saw Sheldon Kennedy now just come to the bench. I tell you, he's been a tower of strength. He's been that seasoned veteran. He plays with a great spirit. He's a credit to that Swift Current Bronco team that he plays for.
In 18 seconds, Canada will have a manpower advantage. Slight delay while Smith takes a new stick over to Desjardins as he prepares for his exit from the penalty box. Savage into the faceoff circle. Fedorov wins the draw. Fedorov now back into the corner after it. Gets away from Leach. This big fella can fly as he comes in across the line. Fedorov tried to go around Lambert, and the Swift Current Bronco product took it away from him. Lambert ahead to Savage. Canada now with a man advantage as it's fired into the Soviet zone. Semeta tried to center it, but Bykovsky was there to poke it away from him, and they dump it down the ice. Going back after it is Foster. Foster almost lost it to Bure. Now Lambert gets it over to Foster. Foster having trouble with the speedy Bure, and Bure is all over Foster. Gets the puck, centers it, and it's knocked down in front. Lambert gets it ahead to Semeta. Semeta going wide as he comes in across the line. Tried to go back to the point, hit the Soviet player. The puck along the boards. Picked up in the corner, now to Shannon. Shannon back at the point. Smith dumps it into the corner. Racine coming out there at the point. A shot, they score! As Castle picks the top corner.
Just good old-fashioned pursuit of the puck. That that's what you call it. Now Castles, get a look here, comes out and picks the upper corner, and the goaltender didn't even know it was in. He went over his shoulder, he was looking for the other side. This Castles, who got the big goal last night, I've seen a lot of them. Matter of fact, I see so much of them, I see too much of them. But I'll tell you, he's a player. He knows the whole ice surface, and he'll play in these big games like that big goal he got. He's come alive when they want him, and it's a great goal. Wrist shot upstairs, it's 1-1, and what a time for it with 1:19 left.
Well, they made a change back in the point. Racine coming out because they wanted to take advantage of his shot. Castles came walking out from the corner, got to the circle, saw that opening, and put it upstairs to tie it at one. Kennedy trying to center it. Brindamore takes a long shot right on. Ivashkin makes the save. They can't clear. Brindamore getting set. He's knocked off the puck by Ivanov. It goes back to the net. Canada trying to center it as Kennedy attempted to slide it out front. Ivashkin held it at the side of the net.
If there were ever some good moments for this Canadian team in this whole tournament, Don, and we've watched most of it, we got to admit this, they've really played well here at spurts, especially this last minute and a half.
Castle's second goal of the tournament at 18:41 with Ricci drawing the assist.
You know what we're seeing some good, you know, they used to talk with all the hockey you covered, Don, we're seeing good wrist shots. Everybody say it would disappear. Some good, really good puck control and things that we've always talked about. Of course, at this kind of competition, you're going to.
Racine, backhand shot in front of the net. McIntyre spun around and fired it high and wide. Ricci, having problems in the corner with Udin, still manages to control the puck, then lost it, and it's knocked out by the Soviets. Sidorov in across the line with Khristich tried to go upstairs again. This time, he went over top of the net, and Canada breaks back. Ricci to McIntyre. McIntyre takes the shot, but Zubov got his stick on it to partially block it. And the reason for the whistle, the Soviet net knocked off its moorings with the play in the center ice area, and 8 seconds remaining in the period, the score tied at one.
Well, I'll tell you, we've seen some hockey, I'll tell you what, some up and down skating, the good old fashioned stuff. You talk about entertainment here in this first period. We've talked so much about this great line of the Soviets. We've seen the Canadians move the puck well, handle the puck, get on the puck, and of course, what can you say about this guy here? I mean, Fassett. I mean, whatever we've said, we haven't said enough, and we seem like we've been talking about him all the time. And I'm happy to see it. He wanted to be here. He's coming here. And if he doesn't make the All-Star team, well, hey, I've been watching the wrong hockey.
Desjardins plays it ahead. Here's a shot by Leach. He scores!
Sure, I saw it. We're going to have to look at this, and he should be consulting. There's no question there should be consultation here. That's one of the things I was upset before.
I thought I saw the green light before the red.
Here we are back into a dispute, and who's on the ice again with the Soviets? We've got, he's ruled it no goal. There's no question he's ruled it no goal. But I tell you, we got to get a look at this, and I think you're right. Now, the shot that it's taken, a good shot inside the blue line. We take a look. The green light is definitely still on. There's no question about it. There's no red light. That green light is on.
There's no question about that. The green light definitely was on before the red came on. There is that delay.
Yes.
Before the red light will come on, once the green goes on to signal the end of the period. And while the Canadian team protested mildly, it did not last very long. So the score remains tied after 20 minutes. Canada won and the Soviet Union won. We'll return after this. Here at the Sullivan Arena has to be pleased with the way this Canadian team came on in the latter half of the period. After the Soviets dominated the first 10 minutes, they outshot Team Canada 15-14 through 20 minutes of play.
Well, just looking at the shots on net and the chances, if we all concede that the Soviets had the first 10 minutes, obviously Canada had to have the second 10 because it was obviously a pretty even game.
Well, I think organizers of this tournament in Anchorage were a little disappointed with some of the crowds during the week, but they are certainly pleased with the full house that is watching this game between Canada and the Soviet Union, the wind-up to the 10 days of competition tonight. Bure trying to work his way in, taken off the puck by Vayu. They bump in the corner, and Murphy plays it around in the boards for Brindamour, who gets it out into the neutral zone. Fedorov, rink wide for Mogilny. Mogilny with a shot, he scores!
Wow, there were two hits on that ice. One with that shot, and then he got decked by the defenseman with the shot, but it was quite a shot, I'll tell you that. He's getting himself up. He's had that bad knee, and we don't know if we can get a look at Mogilny right there where it's, I don't know if he just had the wind knocked out of him and his knee is all right. But we'll see when he comes in. He's met straight up right here, and that is a terrific hit. But he's up again. Watch him come across there. What a terrific clean hit, but the puck went between his legs and it's 2-1. He's now the rest of the team really isn't concerned about him right now. They're just happy to be ahead 2-1, Don.
2-1 is the score. Mogilny letting the shot go just as he was decked by Rod Brindamour. He really flattened the star Soviet player. He was named the outstanding forward in last year's tournament, and he was a key figure on the Soviet team that won the gold medal at the Olympic Games in Calgary. They called him up for the Soviet national team for the Olympic Games after he played on the world junior team in Moscow. So it's 2-1 for the Soviet Union. Udine unable to get it out. Jamie Leach trying to center it, and it's held at the side of the net by Ivashkin as Mike Ricci was there looking for that centering pass from Jamie Leach.
It was interesting. Mogilny was so highly discussed and talked about before the tournament, but he got hurt. Just like Jelena got hurt early, he got hurt. We really haven't seen him until today play like he's playing in this first period and the part of the second.
I think he saves himself for the key games because he was hurt in the first game of the tournament. The word we got was that he had a broken ankle, a broken leg. He had ripped up his knee. There were a variety of reports. And wouldn't you know it, he shows up for the next Soviet game. Then he was injured in that game, had to be carried off the ice. It looked as though he wouldn't play again, but he is flying out there tonight for the Soviet Union. And that goal coming just 20 seconds into the period with Fedorov drawing the assist, and it's 2-1. The Soviets leading Canada. Jamie Leach trying to slide it ahead for Ricci, but Sidorov is there to intercept. In the center ice area, Semeta takes a hit from Khristich, manages to get the puck back over to Smith. Smith, an Edmonton Oilers draft choice, dumping it in. Zubov plays it around on the boards for Khristich. He gets away from a check, in across the line, takes a shot, saved by Fassett. Loose puck in front of the net, Sidorov scores!
That's some sloppy play and some sloppy clearing. And it'll be interesting to see emotionally. We talk about playing this game with some emotion, but what that can do to you when you get a goal scored on you after 20 seconds. Plenty of time here now. The puck is bouncing around. We're not clearing the puck. Bango, he gets it, and he's got that open side. You know, you just can't possibly give that good of a scoring chance to specifically any team, namely the Soviets. Watch them walk in there and right along the ice again, and in, and it's 3-1. And in a minute and 33 seconds from a 1-1 tie, we see a 3-1 game.
So Andrei Sidorov with the second goal in the early stages of this second period for a 3-1 Soviet lead. Now it's Canada with Reggie Savage working towards the net, being watched there by Ivanov. Gets it to Lambert, who is in deep. The Soviets play it around the other side and out. Foster goes back after it, unable to clear. Okusta looking in front. There's nobody there. Lambert starts back for Canada. McIntyre bumped in against the boards. Malik and comes up with it for the Soviets to Okusta. To Gordiuk. Gordiuk with a good move going right in on net. And Fassett comes up with the puck with 17:44 remaining in the second. The Soviets in front by two. The face-off to the right of Fassett back at the line. Sorokin into the corner to Mogilny. He scored after just 20 seconds, and then Sidorov scored 73 seconds later. Mogilny back of the net. Tried to center it. Fedorov at the side of the net is knocked off the puck as Fassett jams it against the mesh, and there'll be another faceoff in the Canadian zone. Well, the Soviets, as they did to start the game, have come out flying to start this second period.
Well, obviously, they've shown the old story. You give them an inch, and they're going to take advantage of it. I mean, this line and place that they wanted, that Tikhonov wanted for the Red Army team, for the number, like these three guys are NHL players typically. You can't give them any room.
Crowd, of course, favoring the Canadian team. Many of the spectators, former Canadians who now live in Anchorage. Dudinyuk battling in the corner. Sheldon Kennedy comes up with the puck. However, the Canadians are unable to control it, and Bure breaks out. Bure crossing with Mogilny. Dumps it into the Canadian zone. Back after it is Murphy. Round on the other side to Racine. To Bryn DeMoor, to Sheldon Kennedy. And it's brought in offside by Murphy after Kennedy had initially moved it in across the Soviet blue line. 16:52 remaining in the period, Brian.
All right, Don, coming up in our second intermission, we will talk with Alexander Mogilny, and we will talk about the rivalry. We'll have a report on the Canadian-Soviet rivalry over the years. Bob McKenzie from the Hockey News will join us, and we'll talk with 17-year-old Mike Ricci of the Peterborough Petes.
Udine in his own zone, trying to move it along the boards. He's dumped. The puck goes back to the net to Zubov. 16:37 left in the period. Krstich in across the line to Sidorov. Sidorov is stopped by Desjardins, who plays it ahead to Leach. Leach drifts a long shot towards the goal. Avashkin grabs it and covers up for a faceoff. And after the whistle, Udine bumped Ricci in against the boards. And the crowd reacts and the players mill about, but I don't think there's going to be any penalty. The referee tonight, Steve Piotrowski of the United States.
Well, he's certainly going to get a little bit more get by than we'd normally see from a European referee and so forth because of his experience. As you're going to see Ricci go over to the corner because he went after the puck before the whistle and gets a little bit of a shot right there. And now there's going to be some crowding around. If it was good old North American hockey, we'd have a delay for 3 or 4 minutes because some people would be grabbing each other. You could be sure of that.
But one of the rules I'd like to see them correct in international hockey is the goaltender freezing the puck, coming out of his net to freeze the puck. They'll go into the corner on occasion to grab that puck. Mogilny, excellent move. He scores. Oh, what a beautiful move by Mogilny. We said at the start of the game, this young man, the most talked about performer here, evidence there of why we spoke that way.
Well, keep that on tape, Grandma, because we want that for hockey school. That's the old story. That's what you show at clinics. You show that kind of a thing. There's no question about it. This guy's up for a big game. He goes with the puck. He stays on it. There's a guy draped over him, and he lets it go just inside the post. Another wrist shot. I mean, hey, this guy can pursue the puck. He's got the speed. He starts to come down. He's got his head up, goes to make the move, brings it back twice with somebody on him, and look at that little bit of opening just over the pad, and it's 4-1 Soviets.
Mogilny obviously saving his best for last. That's his second goal of the game, his sixth of the tournament, and at 3:41 of this second period, it's now 4-1. The Soviet Union leading Team Canada. Okusta in across the line, knocked off the puck, and Lowen has it and dumps it back into the Soviet zone, but this will be an icing call as it's touched by Sorokin. And Sorokin takes a hit in behind the net from Darcy Lowen. And in a previous game, the Canadian team was called a couple of times for those hits after the whistle had gone on an icing call.
Well, we've seen a couple of late hits from both sides, and obviously the ref's letting something like that get by. Tommy Webster's got a little bit of a job here right now, because if anything, they can't let this affect them emotionally, that's for sure. Because it can get a lot worse. They gotta quit looking at the scoreboard and say, we just need one at a time.
From the faceoff, Racine plays it around the boards and down the ice. No icing on this one as Gadanuk goes back to touch it. To Gordiuk. Up along the boards. Gomolyako can't move anywhere with it. He gets a return pass as he moves into center ice. Too far for Gordiuk. Czechoslovakia in the second period, leading Finland by a score of 4-2. Not good news for Canada, because if Canada should lose this game, Canada would be bounced out of the medal picture. They would finish in fourth place.
One of the things the Soviets are doing too is that they have some people coming back to back check.
Okusta battling along the boards. Brindamore goes in there trying to take it away from him. He succeeds. Pass from Murphy to Kennedy. Kennedy in across the line. A drop pass, and Brindamore overskated it. Back comes the Soviet Union. Bure. He has Udine in across the line, and Okusta was offside.
Well, they're a little upset with themselves, you can be sure, too, when you got a 3-on-1 and you have an offside. They can't be happy about that, the Soviets. As a matter of fact, they'll be screaming at each other. I don't care if you're ahead 4-1 or not.
Well, we talked about Czechoslovakia and Finland. 4-2, the Czechs lead. And if they win and Canada loses, the Czechs will get the third-place bronze medal behind the Soviet Union with the gold. Sweden with the silver, and Canada will be relegated to fourth place. So this game for Canada, if that Czechoslovakia-Finland score holds, is the difference between a silver or a fourth place finish.
So needless to say, it's very important to both teams.
And of course, it would affect Canada's seeding for next year as well when the tournament is held in Helsinki. This year, Canada got a break by playing the weaker teams in the tournament early.
That's a heck of a point, because that's a great point that the people should know back home, is that where you finish in this tournament depends on who you play first. And it gives you a little bit of knowing that we don't get very much time to get together. You know, you get to warm up against certain teams.
Well, the scoring leaders in the tournament coming into the game were from the United States, with Roenick and Modano 1-2 with 16 and 15 points respectively. But Bure has a chance to move in and close some of that gap. An interesting thing, Roenick and Modano got most of their points in games against West Germany and Norway, two of the weaker teams in the tournament. They could have used some of that production in the big games.
Well, as a matter of fact, if they'd have got that production in the big games, they would have been in the medals.
Sheldon Kennedy loses it in the center ice area. Smith following up, gets it over to Desjardins, and he dumps it in as Canada makes a change. Back out into the center ice area. Mogilny to Fedorov. He couldn't pick it up in his skates. Manages to get it back for Mogilny to Fedorov. Shot, good save by Fassette. That one was up high. Udine keeps it in at the point, but now Canada brings it out. Rink-wide pass intercepted, and there's an injured Soviet player, and there's going to be a penalty here against Canada. So with 13:55, the Soviets will have a man advantage. Corey Foster is going to the penalty box, a slashing call against Canada. And it was Mogilny who was chopped down in the Canadian zone.
Well, you know, with all due respect to Mogilny, because his talent is unbelievable, he's been on the ice more than the Zamboni. I mean, every time we've seen a number of games, they've carried him off more. I mean, they've used up two stretchers already in this tournament. And that's not to take away from how talented this guy is. But every time he's got hurt, we've had about 30 people out there, and doctors and lawyers, and you name it. We just almost have to clear the rink.
Well, I think in every game there has been at least one occasion where Mogilny has gone down and has required treatment. He's been assisted off the ice, and yet he returns in the very next shift. So the Soviets are on the power play with Sorokin back of his own goal. Lead pass for Panfilenkov. It's a two-line pass offside.
Well, with a minute and 40 to go on this, they have such good puck control and such good speed They'll want to get the puck in very deep. And what do we mean by that? Get it right into the goal line of the Canadian goal line with this big ice surface because they move so well and move the puck so well. This guy just slipped into the boards. You can see him from the point that he's been in a lot of scoring himself as a defenseman.
140 remaining in the penalty to Foster, and that is a rather quiet Canadian bench with 13:35 remaining in the second. Long shot right on. Ashkin makes the save. It looked in the dying seconds of the period as though Canada was going to take a lead, but the goal was correctly waved off as the green light had definitely come on before the puck went into the net. Panfilenkov back to the line to Sorokin. To Panfilenkov at the side of the net. Khristich looking for Panfilenkov, and it was broken up by Racine. Now Racine in the corner trying to clear, having problems there with Khristich. He comes up with the puck to Sorokin. He fakes the shot. Now Sorokin is all set to tee it up again, but the Canadian net is knocked off its moorings by Panfilenkov.
Well, the Canadians are getting another penalty on interference. We're going to see right here where the referee jumps on it and calls interference. Now, watch the Russian player try to go to the net, and now the Canadian takes him out. Calls it interference. And now, with it's going to, for a minute and 2 seconds, it's going to be the 5-on-3 or the 6-on-4, as we noticed in one of the questions yesterday when the Swedish coach kept referring to his goaltender as part of the players. We seem to think that they're not even dressed.
Interference against Yves Racine at 7:03, a two-man advantage for the Soviet Union. Well, that incident took place right in front of the referee, Steve Piotrowski. Not much question that it was an interference call.
Well, Mogilny's recovered. He's back out there with that big line. That good medical reassurance on the bench.
Sorokin to Zubov. Bure back to Zubov. To the line. Fedorov at the side of the net to Mogilny. And he was going across ice looking for Bure, but the Canadian player Desjardins got his stick on it, and it was fired up into the crowd.
Well, there's no question that they've studied the films for sure on this. They know what they're trying to do. They're trying to draw the man out and then put it close to the net. They got two guys parked on the post, and when you got a two-man advantage, it's pretty easy to do. The Canadian defenseman Desjardins is just trying to play in between them. They got to buy some time, at least 44 seconds here, because that's how long they got this two-man advantage. And Mogilny, who's back out there in the cap of the team, he says, I want that hat trick.
Well, Mogilny last year was the scoring leader as the Soviets finished in second place in the tournament in Moscow. He had 9 goals and 9 assists. Bure working to the corner, and the Canadian team was fortunate that another penalty wasn't called. This is Zubov. Zubov for Mogilny. He tried to slide it to the net, and it's picked up by Desjardins. And he dumps it down the ice. Now it's Sorokin. Long lead pass for Bure. Fedorov going for the net. There's the shot. And Fedorov deflected it wide. Mogilny to Fedorov. Fedorov back to Mogilny. Scores! The give and go. Mogilny to Fedorov. He returned it, and the team captain has the hat trick.
Well, the sad part about that is it's only 4 seconds. And what a time to get it. You can see Mogilny, who likes to rub it in himself, pretty excited with his hat trick right here. But as you pointed out, the give and go, and look at him drill that puck. I mean, when he lets it go, he lets it go. That there's a lesson right there. When he snaps it, that sucker is gone, boy. It bulges the twine. It just isn't dumped in the net.
5-1, the Soviet Union now leads Canada, and there is still 1:02 remaining in the penalty to Racine. The score was tied at 1 after 20 minutes of play. The Soviets have blown it open here in the second. And we still have 11:52 remaining. Malykin to Gordiuk. Soviets with a victory will claim the gold medal. A loss would almost certainly drop Canada back into fourth place. Canadians take it back into their own zone, killing off some time. Foster fires it down the ice as Malikin goes back there after. Ivanov gets away from Castles, comes in across the line, loses his stick, and then is stepped into by McIntyre. Back to the line, in front of the net. They score, Okusta! And it's 6-1.
Well, when you got that many people parked in front with that much time, you can be sure that that's a key goal. But when you talk about a time like this, when they get two penalties and score both power play goals at this time to take this kind of a such an overwhelming lead, Canada's got to play very, very smart. Now, obviously, that's, you know, for them to get seven goals against this team, hey, it's pretty tough.
There was the hit at the blue line, but the Soviets managed to control the puck.
Take a look at all the Soviets here. Nobody around, of course, just too much time. And at this time, hey, you can't blame the goaltender, and now we're going to see a goaltending change. But don't ever count Fassette. Fassette saw a lot of Russian players in front of his net there.
Gus Morschauser of the Kitchener Rangers is going to replace Stefan Fassette in goal for the Canadian team. But you can't blame Fassette, the number two choice of the Quebec Nordique in the 1988 amateur draft. Was bombarded in the first period, and he has had Soviet players all over him here in the second as well.
Well, absolutely not. You can see what a competitor that kid is. You know, he's hurt inside, but I'll tell you what, he made some, you know, 6-1 for the chances, some of the chances the Soviets have had here and the saves that he's made. It could be a lot worse.
Bayou goes rink wide with it. 11 minutes remaining in the period. 6-1, the Soviets in front. Vyskovsky drops it for Gordiuk. Gordiuk goes back to the Canadian goal. Lost it there to Lowen. Lowen can't move out. Gordiuk gets it back of the net. Here's a shot right on, and Morschauser makes the save at the side of the net. Vyskovsky trying to go to his backhand, gets it out there. Ring it off the post. Dyspykov let that go off the post. In this second period, the Soviets all over the Canadian team.
They certainly are. You talk about this game played with emotion. Canada's down. They're hurt emotionally. They know the score. And this other team says, hey, we want more, the Soviets say.
Deflected in, but Lowen was offside. 10:09 remaining in the period. Gus Morschauser has replaced Stefan Fassette in goal for Canada. He has seen action in only one game. He played against West Germany in a 7-4 Canadian win.
Well, he gets a test there now. Here's a shot. Look at where you are when you're firing that puck right off the post. You talk about that being a goalie's best friend. We saw an example of it.
Desjardins in his own zone. Lead pass. Deflected down the ice, right on the Soviet goal. Zubov for Khristich. Khristich checked by Desjardins, and Desjardins gets the puck for Canada to Jamie Leach. The crowd reacting to the Canadian team. He tried to center it, but Khristich knocked it to the corner. Now Ricci gets it back to the point. Jeff Smith with a shot, and that is deflected up over the glass and out of play.
Well, we get a look at the Canadian bench, and obviously it's not what you'd call one of jubilation. I mean, they know what's happened. It's an amazing thing about the emotion in this game. That 22nd goal by Mogilny, when they just come out thinking that they were within one second of making it 2-1 at the end of the first period, and then within 20 seconds they were behind 2-1, and they've had a tough time recovering emotionally.
It's a 6-1 game, the Soviets in front. And as we look at that scoreboard and a 6-1 Soviet lead, I look over at Mike Murray, the public relations director, who is keeping stats for us, and he says he can't remember the Canadians ever losing by more than 4 goals since the national team was formed. Can you, Sherry?
No, as a matter of fact, I can't remember either. Hamilton, it was a 4-1 loss, and it was a fairly close game right till the end. As a matter of fact, our records are very, very close. And we can't forget some. You know, Canada's loss to Sweden was their first loss in 13 games of international competition. So let's not forget what's happened here.
Fired down the ice, and this will produce an icing call by the Soviets with 9:10 remaining in the second, and the Soviets taking total control. They're in front by 5. Play just underway. Gomolyako in his own zone. Back of the net for Sorokin. Up into the center ice area, and what a hit there as the Soviet player was decked by John McIntyre. He caught him with a hip. And really sent him flying. Watch as the Soviet player, Malikin, is sent flying.
Well, there's no question he's hit there. I mean, that kid is hurt. He's down on the ice because he's hurt. He's not moving anything at all. I don't know what they're checking here. They seem to be, all of a sudden he's getting up. You know, these guys, you don't know how badly hurt. I don't mean to take that away from it at all, as a matter of fact, because if they're hurt, they're hurt. But I thought it was his knee that was hurt, but he seems to be moving his legs, and they, unless he hit his head or something like that, we really don't have any way to know what's really hurt, because they don't seem to be doing anything except talking to him.
Well, McIntyre came across with a good, clean body check.
They were right. They went to the referee right away when a guy gets hurt. They wanted another power play opportunity. And he seems to be favoring the leg all right when he gets up. Well, we get it. He gets that right across the hip and above the knee and really tangles him. You can be sure of that. And that seems to be what he's favoring, as a matter of fact, when he picked his legs up there when he comes off.
Well, that's Viktor Gordiuk, the injured player. And he is going to the bench. The Canadian team has dished out some of the really good body checks of this tournament. You may recall in the game against Czechoslovakia, Racine seemed to separate Rob from every piece of his equipment. And yet he was able to come back and play for the Czechoslovakian team.
That Czech team has always been gritty, Don.
Shannon has it, takes a shot in front of the net. Castles attempted to deflect the puck, but he couldn't get a stick on it. Zypikov in the center ice area, fires it in. Lambert has it back of the goal for Team Canada. 8:21 remaining in the period. Broken up at the line. McIntyre gets it again, dumps it in. And it's Bykovsky for the Soviets, bringing it back. Bykovsky has been pretty much a fourth liner during most of this tournament for the Soviet Union. But he's seeing more action in this game than he has in some of the previous contests. Khristich in across the line, drops it there for Bure. Bure bumped in against the boards by Desjardins, and Ricci has the puck for Canada. He plays it off the glass and out. Malikin takes over for the Soviets. The big defenseman fires it in deep. As a matter of fact, he puts it up over the glass and out of play.
Well, you talk about a miracle on ice, and Eric Desjardins was there with the gold medal in his hand last year in Moscow, and you can be sure the Soviets remember losing that gold medal last year. And he's here. He's done a great job of leading this team this year. As a matter of fact, he's been a stalwart on the blue line, played all the specialty teams, and he's sitting there dejected. He knows what it's like to be on the winning side and the losing side. And if you talk about miracles on ice, when you're behind 6-1 against the Soviets, that's what they're hoping for right now, that Canadian team.
It's much more fun being on the winning side, too.
It sure is. I know exactly what you're talking about.
Going back after it is Ivanov. Kennedy went charging in with him. Back to the line. Bayou hit the side of the net. And the Soviets clear the zone. 7:13 remaining in the period. Stolen by Khristich. In across the line. Khristich getting set. Saved by Morschauser. Panfilenko in the corner trying to get away from Racine. Still has it. Looking into the slot, Ivanov moving in, puts it wide. Canada comes back, led by Bryn DeMoor, as the Soviets came close to adding to their five-goal advantage. Sebastian, on that rolling puck, simply drops on top of it and holds it for a face-off.
You know, one of the things, you know, we seem to key in so much, we're behind 6-1 here. We got to remember, as we said, we talked about the key loss to Sweden. That's Canada's first loss, correct me if I'm wrong, gone in 13 games in international competition at the junior level. Then they come back, so this will only be their second loss in 16 games. So you don't overshadow the fact what a good job they have been doing.
Bure has the puck for the Soviets. He was trying to hit Mogilny in full flight in the center ice area. Mogilny behind his back to Fedorov, going in. Morschauser's got it.
Well, even Fedorov, who I think is the centerman, is one of the best quarterbacks he played last year. He's talking to himself right now. And give that Gus Morschauser coming in here cold like that when they're down, and he's only played one game. But watch Fedorov. He's got clear sailing. He's going and he says, listen, I'm going to take it to my backup. Morschauser stays with him and grabs it out of the air. That Morschauser kid that plays for the Kitchener Rangers was a free agent. He just wouldn't give up. He went in there, was not drafted in junior hockey, stayed with it. Hey, that's staying with that puck. And that Fedorov, he's a world-class player. Make no mistake of that.
He was a member of the All-Star team last year along with Mogilny. And they are the only two members of last year's All-Star team who are not playing professional hockey this year in the NHL. Greg Haugud is with the Boston Bruins. Theron Fleury was just called up to the Calgary Flames. Teppo Numminen is with the Winnipeg Jets, and Jimmy Waite with the Chicago Blackhawks. He would probably have been with this team had he not suffered a broken collarbone just before the Canadian team went to camp.
Does that tell you a little bit about the call? I mean, this is a who's who when you talk about Gustafson and McCart, Siltanen and Gretzky and Naslin and Stastny and Steen and Tarasov and Lindbergh and Lube and Larionov. I mean, you can go on and on. It's a who's who of hockey that's played in this tournament. So, you know, when you only lose two games in 16, and this is a who's who of hockey of 19 and 18-year-olds, because almost all of them go on not only to play, but most of them stars in the NHL.
Fired in, Leach after it. Leach takes a shot, hits the side of the net. Picked up by Shannon. Shannon out front, and Leach was waiting for that pass, but it was intercepted by Bykovsky. Leach brings it back for Canada. Leach takes a shot, glove save. Big rebound dumped to the corner by Udine. Racine was unable to keep it in. He waits for his teammates to clear the zone before shooting it back into Soviet territory. Then it's fired down the ice. And with 5:26 remaining in the period, an icing call against the Soviet Union.
Well, it takes a few minutes every period, it seems. They've played some very, very good hockey here. They've had some pressure. They've had some chances. They're obviously not reading the scoreboard, which says something about how they've regrouped a little bit here. They got to forget about that score now. Now it's a question of playing for pride. Let's break it down. Let's chip it down one or two at a time. Let's not be blowing out. That's what they got to be saying to themselves. That's what they got to be talking on the bench.
Reg Savage in the faceoff circle. Gets it back to the point. Foster with a shot, caught and held by Ivashkin in goal for the Soviet Union.
You know, one of the things that we were talking about, and I'd heard today, I was at a dinner here with the Rotary, as a member of Rotary in Canada, and about the few rinks that they have in Russia. But in effect, it doesn't look like, it looks like they got a lot more than we have the way they're playing today.
Reggie Savage, drafted by the Washington Capitals. General manager David Poyle of the Capitals was here observing him during the tournament. He talked about the number of National Hockey League scouts and general managers in attendance. I think better than 60 applied and received accreditation for this tournament. Jack Button, the scout for the Capitals, was also here, and they were keeping a close eye, of course, on Reggie Savage. He's got a good touch around the net.
David Poyle was here, too. I think he came in for at least a week or so. The general manager of Washington.
Malikin for Khristich. He stopped at the line. Bryn DeMoor comes in across the line looking for Savage. Savage had to reach out for the puck. Plays it back to the line. Lambert can't keep it in. Panfilenkov breaking out, and Lambert brought him down. Lambert looked at the official. I'm sure he thought he was going to be called on a penalty, but there was no whistle.
The Soviet player looked too. I mean, he took a little bit of a dive. He could feel. Of course, everybody does it. All our players feel if you can get that little extra fall and get the referee's attention, but unfortunately not to his benefit.
The Soviets trying to win their 8th World Junior Hockey Championship. They won in 77, 78, 79, and 80. Then in the 82 season, the Canadian national team was formed. Prior to that, Canada had been represented by junior clubs. And the Soviets, since the formation of the Canadian national team, have won 3 times in 83, 84, and again in 86. Canada has also won 3 times, the national junior team capturing the gold medal on 3 different occasions.
That's also an interesting stat. That shows you how close we've, since we put the national program together, they've each won 3 gold medals. They look like they're going for their 4th, but the program isn't going to end this year, you can be sure of that.
Shannon unable to clear the zone. Mogilny knocked off the puck. Bure picks it up. Bure takes a shot from a sharp angle. It's blocked by Morschhauser. Mogilny has it. Mogilny already with 3 goals. Going back at the net, sliding it out for Fedorov, and a glove save by Morschhauser.
Well, it seems to me that the Canadians don't have a lot of trouble in goal, do they? Because this young Gus Morschhauser comes in here and has made a couple of dazzling saves. Now here we're going to see a point-blank shot out of the slot. When we say out of the slot, right between the circles there, going for the corner. I mean, that was labeled. And that wasn't some kind of a flip shot. Morschhauser's right there. Now look at where he's shooting from. I mean, that's where you want. And he is right there to grab it.
Racine now back of his own net. 3:30 remaining in the period. He dumps it down the ice. Udine up along the boards. Vaikovsky gets it out, and the Canadians with Vaiu in control. Ahead to Semeta. He dumps it in. Vaiu pinching in from the point. Plays it back of the goal to Ricci. Ricci knocked off the puck by Vaikovsky, and he brings it out for the Soviets. Vaikovsky shot, it goes off a leg, loose puck. The Soviet player manages to get a stick on it, tries to dump it in, but Canada clears the zone, and this will be an icing call as Ivanov goes back to touch it. 2:47 remaining in the period, the Soviets leading by 5.
You know, when we talk and we zero in here on this Soviet defenseman, I want to mention something. They feel there's such a shortage of rinks, and the kids in the Soviet Union aren't coming out. When they used to, they literally advertised for this program for people. They used to have 1,000 kids there for tryouts. Now they only have 100. They've got a program now on in the Soviet Union to build 40 new rinks to get them into some of the new areas. You know what to find out, Don, that the kids have told them in the Soviet Union that they got more to do now. And so that they're not that interested. You know, I don't know if you've ever heard that story before.
Sounds familiar, doesn't it?
I guess it does. But you know, when we really get a look at it, things aren't so different after all.
2:47 left in the period from the faceoff. Sidorov back to the line. Malikin with a shot through traffic. Morschhauser makes the save. And now Canada brings it up. Brindamore with Kennedy. Kennedy going for the net. Brindamore was unable to get it to him. Ivanov and Brindamore battle in the corner. Now it comes up along the boards to Panfilenkov. And he leads the 3-on-2 for the Soviets. Panfilenkov trying to go between the defensemen. Foster stopped it. Malikin keeps it in, fires it wide. From the other point, Ivanov knocks it back of the goal for Sidorov. Sidorov gets it back to the line. Ivanov with a shot. It is blocked in front. The rebound is flipped up high, and Morschhauser has that one.
You know what we're going to see as we get a look at Gus Morschhauser again? Is that the Soviets always have a player in the Canada's end, right between the circles, at the top of the circles. They bring that guy in late. He's very disciplined. That's something that we all try to teach in this sport, David. We call it forming a triangle in the offensive zone, and not to get too technical. But the point is, they have that guy there, so he's there to back check. At the same time, he's there to get that shot because that's the best spot to score from. And the defensemen have to come out a long ways to cover it.
Jardin along the boards for McIntyre. To Lowen. Lowen centering it. McIntyre was going for the net, looking for the deflection, and he knocks the nets off the moorings in the process. 1:48, the time remaining in this second period. The Soviets scored at the 22nd mark, McGilney's fifth goal. At 1:33, Sidorov, his fifth goal of the tournament. At 3:41, it was McGilney again. And then at 9:01, McGilney with the hat trick, and Okusta at 9:52. And that's the way it stands, 6-1. Soviet Union leading Canada. Lone Canadian goal in the first period by Castles. Fired down the ice by the Soviets. Desjardin will touch it for an icing call.
Well, it's just a question of clearing the puck for this faceoff. The Soviets are obviously going to play it very, very safe in their own end. Nothing fancy here. You get a 6-1 lead with a minute and 41 seconds. They're just saying, let's get the period over and let's get out of here. You know, one of the other things that we've heard, all this information that we've been gathering, you and I, is the Soviet players say that by the time they finish their careers, they're so old, to start another career, it's too late.
Jeff Smith with a shot right on. Nathashkin makes the save. Canada applying some pressure. Smetov, friendly score! Ricci knocks it in.
A credit to the Peterborough Petes. He stands in there and takes punishment. When you're going to stand in front of the net like that, you're going to take a lot of heat, as we say. Sometta sees him. He's right there, and he stays on the puck, and it's in the net. People draped all over him. You know, for a 17-year-old, I'd often said, I wonder if a 17-year-old can lead a junior A team. Never mind lead a junior A team. He's come in here and led a world championship team in Team Canada.
Well, a number of these players are eligible to play again for Team Canada in Helsinki, Finland next year. Ricci, of course, one of them. He gets the goal from Semeta at 18:30 of this second period. Now it's Okusta. Okusta in front of the net is knocked off the puck, and Canada clears the zone. Picked up by Bayou. Bayou in across the line. Tried to drop it back to the point. There's nobody there. And there's a delayed penalty coming up here against Canada as Bykovsky for the Soviets circles back into his own zone. They get the extra attacker out there. We're into the final minute of the period. Mogilny for the Soviets. To Sipika, to Mogilny. He tried to go rink wide, and as it's touched by Racine, the whistle goes. Another slashing call against Canada.
Seems to me a slashing call out of the play. One of the things, you know, we talk about, you can't be getting those kind of penalties out of the play, no matter whether the score is 6-2 or 2-1.
Vaiu is going to the box. That occurred behind the play after he had gone in deep and threw it back to the point. There was nobody there. And he was called for slashing.
Sometimes it's a little frustration. You throw a pass emotionally. Everything's done instinctively here. And the secret of this game is to do things right more often than the other team. And of course, our good camera people, give them credit. Well, he got him, and the referee's right there to see it. It's the old frustration. Give our camera people a lot of credit. They're right on the play. You know, we don't see those things that, under the good direction of our director and our producer, the unheralded people that make us look good, Don.
Brent Haywood and Lee Herberman. Eric Desjardin. Back of the net, loses it. The Soviets to the line, to Sorokin. Sorokin for Bure. Mogilny calling for the puck behind the goal. Bure goes to the point instead. Sorokin looked as though he was going to tee it up. Gives it back to Bure into the slot to Fedorov, and he fanned on it. He was all set. He had that stick poised and ready, and he fanned on it. Now it's Sorokin. Lets the shot go. Morischauser kicks that to the corner. Malika or Mogilny. He tried to center it. It bounces high. They battle for it back of the net. Fedorov comes up with it to Mogilny. He already has three goals. Out front, Malika banned on the shot just as the siren sounds to end the period. 1:10 still remaining in the penalty to Vayu, the Soviet Union leading Canada by a score of 6-2. Brian?
All right, Don, coming up during our second intermission, we will talk with Mike Ricci of the Peterborough Petes, the 17-year-old sensation who has just scored the second Canadian goal. We will have
got to earn it as an individual also, and it's an interesting comment to hear from that executive of the Federation and Soviet Union.
Well, of course, Vyazmykin and Tatarinov were two outstanding members of this Soviet junior team.
Well, Don, we talk about going back in this tournament, and I mean this quite respectfully and not just to make you feel good. You do a lot of hockey. You've watched a lot of hockey. You come from a hockey hotbed. You're a senior play-by-play man, and you've been watching international competition and calling it. He's got a rate as one of the best you've seen, I'm sure of it. And what about that whole line? As a line, you and I have visited, I don't remember in junior hockey a better line as a group of three players. I don't know if you do.
Well, I'm sure that if the National Hockey League scouts in attendance thought there was any way that any of these Soviet players could get out of the country and join teams in the National Hockey League next year or the year after, there'd be a lot of Soviet names in the very first round of the draft.
Well, I told some of the general managers, I asked them specifically if they could get two or three of these guys, would you send your scouts to Florida for the rest of the year? They said without question, they'll take them. But obviously, that's the point here. Here's a crucial situation. That penalty now, we talk about self-respect. They can't, they don't want to blow it. They got a minute and 10 seconds now to kill off that power play. And we know already how effective the Soviet Union had been, been with that power play and that added man. And you can be sure they're not happy yet. They just soon get six more.
Gus Morschauser continues in goal for Team Canada. He replaced Stefan Fassette midway through the second period. Morschauser, since coming in, has not yielded a goal. He has made some tremendous saves. Here's a race for the puck. Canada going in. A backhand shot by Kennedy. And the save from a sharp angle is made by the Soviet goaltender Ivashkin. Long shot from the point as Smith stopped that long attempted pass by the Soviet Union. Bure comes wheeling out of his zone, gets away from Ricci. Bure can really fly, goes back of the net to Mogilny. Back to Bure. Mogilny at the side of the circle, back to the line. Gordinuk over to the other side for Sorokin. Off the boards for Mogilny. Back to the point to Gordinuk. He takes a shot, deflected, score!
They all catch. You talk about understanding pool and banking the shots. That's precisely what happened, but I gotta tell you, they laid that puck into him and it had eyes. It went in the corner of the net. And it was a good play by the defenseman instead of blasting and hitting somebody. Now look at us, I was telling you earlier in the game, that centerman for the Soviet Union, he sits out there, now the puck is thrown, just deflect it as he's going the other way. Not Morschauser's fault whatsoever, not at all. In the net, 7-2.
Fedorov got his stick on it to deflect that shot from the point by Gudinik, but the big thing the Soviet defenseman did was keep it on the ice.
Exactly right, and read that guy deep. If you notice, they always score early in the period to get things going for themselves and take advantage of their opportunities.
Eugene tries to clear, but Shannon gets the puck. He can't get a shot away as he was tied up by Panfilenko. Eugene again trying to get it out. He's bumped by McIntyre. It's knocked up along the boards, and Shannon is back in the neutral zone. Shannon knocks it to the line, broken up there by the Soviets. Sidorov to Khristich. Khristich takes the shot, gets it back again as it bounced off a leg. Then he's checked by Foster. McIntyre unable to clear. The Soviets get it. Over to Panfilenkov, to Khristich in the slot. He couldn't get a shot away. He was tied up by Foster. The puck comes to the side of the net, and Morschauser covers up there for Team Canada. Fedorov from Bure and Mogilny, although the defenseman will have to get the assist in that. Czechoslovakia ahead of Finland 4-2 at the end of the second period, and it looks as though Czechoslovakia is going to capture the bronze medal if they can hang on to that two-goal advantage, because Canada trails 7-2. Brindamore had his pass blocked in the center ice area, picked up by Lyspikov, his shot wide of the net. Lyspikov bumped heavily in the corner. Bayou plays it up high down the ice. Malikin racing back after it, being chased by Savage. The two of them collide in the corner. Good effort there by Savage racing after that puck. But now the Soviets bring it out. Tyspikov to Bykovsky. Back into the slot. Mogilny fires it wide, and he's hit in that slot area as he and Brindamore collided. It was Brindamore who sent Mogilny flying in the second period after he scored a goal. Reg Savage comes back for Canada. He was trying to slide it through to Kennedy, stopped by the Soviets with 17:30 remaining in the period. The Soviets make a line change. Lead pass. Gomolyako stopped by Morschauser, and back comes Canada. Semeta through the center ice area. It's offside as Jamie Leach was ahead of the play with 17:15 left in the period.
Well, they haven't changed it officially yet, but Gadynyuk should get an assist on that goal along with Mogilny, and they'll probably take the assist away from Bure, because it was definitely his shot from the point that was deflected by Fedorov. That deflected puck is grabbed and held by Ivashkin for a faceoff.
You know, Don, we talk about playing tough. We always think of that as being physical. If there's ever a time you got to play tough emotionally, when you're down 7-2 in a gold medal game with a packed rink and a national TV audience, emotionally, you got to play tough. You got to come off that bench. You got to forget about it. It is no easy trick. We're going to learn a lot about this team right now.
Ricci in the circle. The draw comes back to Smith at the line. He couldn't get a shot away. Canada trying to keep it in, but Zubov gets it out into the neutral zone. Semeta, nice move to get away from Fedorov as he tries to come in across the line. He collides with Yudin, and it's dumped down the ice into Canadian territory. Morschauser out of his net to play it along the board. Bure got it, tried to center it. It's blocked by Desjardins. 16:28 remaining in the third period. Leach is stopped at the Soviet line. Clearing attempt kept in by Lambert to Semeta. He blasts it wide. In the corner, Semeta takes a good hit in against the boards from Fedorov as the puck is cleared out into the center ice area.
Is that Bure everywhere, or is that just me?
He can fly. All the scouts in attendance have raved about the speed of Pavel Bure.
He may be one guy on ice they may have to give a pilot's license to.
Malikin back into his own zone. He was looking into the center ice area for Sidorov. It was intercepted by Team Canada. 15:45 remaining in the game. The Soviets leading by a score of 7-2. Lowen races into the corner. He's out there with Jelena. Jelena couldn't get a stick on it. Lowen leaves it there for Jelena. It's taken away by Khristich. Played up along the boards for Sidorov. Clearing attempt intercepted. Racine with a shot. And that's steered to the corner by Ivashkin. Jelena tried to bang it off the boards. Gordiuk to Khristich. Khristich to Panfilenkov. Panfilenkov into the slot area. And that's saved by Morschauser off Gadynyuk. Soviets coming close to making it 8-1 with 14:59 remaining in the third. They lead 7-2. Brian?
Just a reminder, Don, Sports Weekend coming up this Saturday afternoon. Figure skating features Katarina Witt and friends. We will have the men's downhill same-day coverage of the race from Switzerland. That's Sports Weekend coming up at 3 Eastern Saturday. That is 12 noon on the West Coast.
The Canadian team will be returning home tomorrow, and for the majority of the players, they will, of course, be returning to their junior teams or to the university club for which they perform. Eric Desjardins will probably be heading for the Montreal Canadiens. He has been with them for much of the season. And what a roll the Canadiens are on.
Oh, I tell you, What a roll they're on, and what a roll they're on in getting some players. They got three or four good ones right in this tournament.
Mikovsky works to the corner against Bayou. Plays it back to the line. Sorokin manages to keep it in, and it's knocked out into the neutral zone. Shannon took a shot off a leg, and the Soviets dump it back into Canadian territory. Smith dumps it out. Team Canada making a change. Pass intercepted. Here's Castles going in alone. On the back end, he fired a fly, and he collides with the goaltender, Ovechkin. He couldn't go to his forehand because of the two Soviet players who were coming across.
He showed what a good puck control he has, but that good backhand of his, as a matter of fact, he scored on a backhand last night. Watch him come in. He knows he can't bring it around. He brings it outside where they can, and he's going for that upper corner. He misses the net. Hey, speaking of Montreal Canadiens, every time we talk about a player, like, does that organization do a lot of right things? Is it, you know, it's not an accident that that team's on a roll. I mean, they know, you know, there's another good player of theirs, and he labeled. He was looking for that corner. That was no accident.
He collided with the goaltender of Ovechkin. And Ovechkin repairs some equipment. The net is replaced. And he'll go back in goal for the Soviet Union. Well, we said there were transplanted Canadians in a large number here in Anchorage, Alaska. And there are a number of Canadian flags and signs being waved about Sullivan Arena tonight. It seems that every second person we talk to in this building indicates that they are here from some part of Canada. 7-2 is the score. The Soviet Union leading Canada with 14:07 remaining in the hockey game. It was 1-1 after 20 minutes, and then the Soviets broke it open with a couple of quick goals to start the second, and by the midpoint of the period, they were in front by a score of 6-1.
They've certainly taken, you know, you talk about winning hockey games, they get an opportunity, those Russians and the Soviets, they're going to put the puck in the net.
Shot from the point by Smith is blocked by Oksyuta. Now it's Gordia on the left side. Oksyuta with a shot. It's just wide. Desjardins plays it off the glass and down the ice. Udine goes back after it. His pass intercepted by Savage. Savage has to wait for Sheldon Kennedy to get back onside. Now Kennedy takes the pass. Off the boards for Savage, and it's offside. Brenda Moore coming in on the right wing was ahead of the play.
You know, there are two teams in attendance here tonight that are disappointed. The Canadian team on the ice, and you can be sure that the team from Sweden is not too excited about that score. And as you pointed out very early in the game, if Canada cannot get a goal, they can get a silver. That's the best they can get. But if they win today, you know what happens. The Swedes get it. And there's this player we've been talking about with the lit up laces. But I'll tell you something. As I said before, he should get a pilot's license to play, because that's how quick he is on the ice.
Well, since the national team program was formed, Canada has only finished out of the medals on two occasions previously, 1984, and then in that punch up in Piashtani in 87, when both the Soviets and the Canadians were disqualified. But Canada has won three gold medals. Here's Bure, watch him fly, going for the net. Back of it, tries the wraparound, gets it again. As he pounced on that rebound, but the Canadian player, Ricci, took it away from him and dumped down the ice. Bure in the neutral zone, he has Mogilny to his left. Long shot off a stick, high up into the crowd. 12:45 is the time left, 7-2 is the score. Along with Sherry Basson at the Sullivan Arena in Anchorage, the final game of the World Junior Tournament, and the Soviets are destined to win the gold medal, barring a remarkable comeback in the final 12-28 by Team Canada. The Soviets lead it by a score of 7-2. Bayou into the neutral zone for McIntyre. He's dished out some good body checks tonight. Gdyniak picks it up in the corner, slides it ahead to Khristich, to Panfilenkov. He's hit, knocked down by Smith. Khristich knocked off the puck by Castles, but he still managed to get it back to Panfilenkov, who fed it to Ivanov, but he couldn't get a shot away. Dumped into the corner, Sidorov for the Soviet Union. He's checked, the loose puck picked up by Smith. Smith is bumped. Shannon having problems getting out. Smith following up on the play, clears the zone. The Soviets making a change. Malikin waiting for his teammates to get on the ice as he slides it over to Udine. Dumped into the Canadian zone, Lambert. Long lead pass for Kennedy, and this will produce an icing call against Canada as Kennedy touched it on his side of the red line.
Well, as you said, we're going to need some miracles here. And the real issue is not worried about winning a hockey game, as we talked about real early here, is just maintaining their own prestige and pride here. And don't let them blow it out, because they're going to want to definitely embarrass Canada, because that 3-2 win with these good players in the Soviet Union, that hurt them last year. You can be sure of that.
The Soviets have dominated this World Junior Tournament, but not as much since Canada went to the national team program. They won 4 of their gold medals prior to the formation of that national program. The first year, of course, was in Winnipeg in 1982. The final game played in Rochester, but in the game played in Winnipeg, Canada destroyed the Soviet Union. Good hit in the corner by Lambert. Mikoski, however, manages to come up with the puck, centered it, cleared to the line. Udine takes the shot. Morschauser with the save. Kennedy ahead to Savage. Savage is bumped in the neutral area. And the Soviets, Mogilny, stopped at the line. Zubov circles back into his own zone as the Soviets make some changes. Pass ahead to Mogilny. He couldn't do anything with it. And Racine takes over for Canada. All he can do is play it off the boards into the neutral zone. Back comes Ivanov. Ivanov into the slot to Mogilny, to Fedorov. Saved by Morschauser. And now Lowen breaks up, reaching, trying to catch up with the play. In the slot area, Fedorov came back to tie up Ricci and deflect it to the corner. Ricci gets it again, back to the net, into the slot area, and it bounced away from Leach, who was all set looking for that centering attempt. Mogilny for Ivanov, off the boards to the Canadian line, picked up there by Racine. Rink wide, Leach working to the corner, bumped by Malikin. Ricci comes in as well. The puck comes loose to Leach, trying to center it, bounces high. Gomolyakov brings it out for the Soviets. He's tied up as he comes in across the line by Smith. Desjardins plays it off the boards and down the ice, and this will be an icing call against Canada. 9:22 is the time remaining in the third period. Face off to the right of Gus Morschauser. 7-2. The Soviets lead Canada, and the Soviets are headed for the gold medal. Canada has won 3 previous gold medals in 82, 85, and 88. They took the silver in 77 and 1986, the bronze in 78 and 83. Coming into this game, a Canadian victory would have meant a silver medal, with the gold going to Sweden. But now it looks as though Canada is going to finish out of the medals. Czechoslovakia, with a victory over Finland by a score of 7-2, will capture the bronze. Shannon dumping it in. Gdyniak back into the corner, trying to clear. Desjardins kept it in, but then it bounces to Oksyuta, to Gomolyakov. His shot, a weak one, slides wide. He's sent flying in against the boards by Desjardins. They battle for that puck in there, and the Soviets come up with it. They tried to get it back to the point, but it was intercepted by Canada. Shannon shoots it in and then goes to the bench on the change with 8:26 remaining in the third. 7-2, the Soviets lead Canada.
Stolen by Brindamour at the line. Brindamour trying to play it back to the point to Lambert, but the Soviet player knocked it out into the neutral zone.
One of the things that should be noted is that the Soviets play very good positional hockey in the offensive zone and defensive. They're very patient and wait for that puck. They're right up by the blue line, and then they break out.
Lead pass to Sidorov. Sidorov looking for Khristich, and it was up high as it was deflected. He never got a shot away. Murphy comes back for Canada to Brindamour. Centering it, and racing in was Kennedy, but he couldn't get to it. Now the Soviets break out 2-on-1. Drop back for Panfilenkov. Panfilenkov into the slot area. Excellent play by Lambert. Ivanov with a shot. Saved by Morschauser, and it's dumped down the ice.
Well, I'll tell you one thing. That was very well played by the Canadian defenseman. Although, hey, when you're coming in, you got to do things instinctively. And the Soviets just took too much time, let the Canadians get back in the play, and Morschauser made that big save. Again, you'll notice that they're getting some very good chances from what we call a deep slot, Don, which is, again, between the circles offensively. Too good of an area to get in. You're going to score too many chances. You get enough there, they're going to go in the net. We've seen Mogilny do it a few times.
Soviets only loss in the tournament, that 5-3 setback at the hands of Czechoslovakia. And what a big win that turned out to be for the Czechs, because with their triumph tonight, they wind up in the bronze medal position, 7-2 over Finland. And it's interesting that in this tournament, the bottom team is relegated to the B pool. Norway and West Germany today were playing for that last position, and Norway won it by a score of 4-2. So Norway stays in the A pool. West Germany will be in the B pool next year.
A lot of big games today, and that was one of them. To those teams, you can be sure.
Bure trying to control it as he works against Racine. They continue that battle along the boards. Vykovsky in there as well. So is Ricci. And Bure is tenacious. He tried to get it back to the slot to Ivanov. And then he takes a good hit along the boards. Now Nalika gets it back of the net for Racine. Racine plays it off the glass to center ice. Ivanov is back for the Soviets. He shoots it into Canadian territory. Racine has it with 6:36 left in the game. 7-2, the Soviets lead it. Pass too far for Leach. Ahead to Mogilny. Mogilny knocked off the puck. Picked up by Panfilenkov, right in the save by Morschauser. Since taking over from Stefan Fizet, Morschauser, who plays for the Kitchener Rangers, has made some good saves.
Far no embarrassment on that kid's part, I'll tell you that. Nobody can blame the goaltenders in this tournament for the Canadian team. They've been outstanding, to say the least.
Mogilny, who has scored 3, stopped as he comes in across the line. Up off the glass, Canada breaks out. Lowen coming in with Desjardins. To Desjardins, he couldn't get a shot away. He was tied up by Mogilny. The scoring star for the Soviet team did a good job of coming back to pick up his check.
Well, to say the least, that Soviet team's been working hard, as we call, in both ends of the rink, Don. And that's exactly why they're ahead 7-2.
5:31 remaining in the game. The Soviet Union heading for the gold medal in front by 5. Underway in the Soviet zone. Lambert tees it up, a high shot. That hit a Soviet player in front of the net. Brindamour battling with Udine along the boards. Oksyuta comes in as well. So does Savage. He gets it loose to Lambert. Kennedy goes into the corner with Zubov. Kennedy is knocked down. It comes out to the line. Penalty coming up here against the Soviet Union as Foster has it. Could be a charging call as Kennedy was really decked in the corner. No, it's an elbowing penalty.
Well, when you talk about Kennedy, he's been very impressive as one of the veterans here. He plays very, very hard every second he's out there. So now we're going to see two things. We're going to see the power play, of course, of the Canadians. But what I want you to, the people to watch for is how aggressive the Soviets play when they're shorthanded. It'll be interesting to see if they still do it when they're ahead 7-2. But they play very, very aggressive. They go after the puck wherever it is.
An elbowing call against Zubov at 15-10 of the third period. Racine dumps it in to Ricci in front of the net. As Leach took a swipe at it and the Soviets knock it out. Dumped back in by Canada. And it's called in the offside. Tom Webster, who coaches the Windsor Spitfires, the former coach of the New York Rangers until illness forced him out of that position, has to be disappointed with what has transpired here tonight. He came into this game with high hopes of the Canadian team leaving Anchorage with at least a silver medal.
Good character guy, too. Teaches his kids some very, very good people skills.
It was that five-goal outburst in the first 9 minutes of the second period that did the Canadian team in. Pass cross ice for Desjardins as he had moved in from the point, but he couldn't reach it. And again, the Canadian team is called in the offside with 1:24 remaining in the penalty.
Well, as we said earlier, we noticed that the Soviets on the puck. They're very, very aggressive. They're not going to sit back and let you set, but we, you know, to get set with your power play. They go after that puck. They got a lot of confidence in themselves, and they're going to, what we know as pressure. They like to put a lot of pressure on whoever has the puck. Don't give them time to think. Don't give them time to deal with the puck. They'll put a lot of pressure on you, and they've been quite successful at it.
Four 11 remaining in the game. 7-2, the Soviet Union leads Canada. Indeed. Shannon battling for it along with Castles. Khristich is in there for the Soviet Union. Castles gets it out in front to Desjardins. He couldn't get a shot away. Gets it again. Tries a backhander that is blocked. And the Soviets bring it out. Khristich working to the line. Khristich trying to go around Racine. Knocked off the puck. Desjardins gets it over to Racine. Big Canadian defenseman works his way into the neutral zone. 44 seconds left in the penalty. Racine back to the net out front. And Shannon couldn't get a shot away as he was checked. Finally, from a bad angle, he fires it high and wide in the corner. Gudinuk knocked off the puck. Back to the point. Lambert tees it up, lets the shot go just wide. He almost picked the far corner. Foster plays it back of the goal. Castles. For Canada, moving all the way back to the line. He scored the Canadians' first goal of the hockey game. For Lambert, back of the net to Shannon. Shannon tried to center it. It went off a leg to the corner. Now it's Castles to McIntyre. The Soviets again at full strength. McIntyre gets it back to the line. Lambert lets a shot go. It's blocked by the Soviet player Panfilenkov, and he bangs it out into the neutral zone, and we've got a penalty coming up here. A slashing call, and it's against Team Canada. I think Lambert will be going off.
Yes, it is when he got that puck. Well, you'll notice the Soviets didn't give him any chances out in front of the net. They let him have the puck outside. Now we're going to see the opposite. Now we're going to see the opportunities that they get. They just aggressively killed off a penalty. Now they'll get the power play for the next 2 minutes. A couple things I want to say, Don. I really want to talk about this. One, about the great hospitality we got while we were here by the people of Anchorage. I tell you, they really went out of the way. They deserve this. They deserve to host the Olympics. They got the facility. They're good people. But the second thing I want to talk about is the good people on this crew and what a great job they did. And I want to compliment you, the old veteran, to hold a guy like me up.
Don't use that word old, please.
Well, yes, but that's true. I got to tell some facts, too. You know what I mean? And I don't even care if it sounds schmaltzy or not. The people behind the scenes that do the work on this thing to hold people like myself up, I tell you, they do a great, great job, a heck of a job, and I'm just proud to be part of it.
Oh, it's a pleasure having you here, Sherry, working with us. General manager of the Oshawa Generals in the Ontario Hockey League, for those who may not be familiar with our color commentator, and on three occasions, the general manager of the Canadian team at the World Hockey Championships, twice winning the gold medal in 1982 and again in 1985.
I know how these guys feel on both ends. I know what the jubilation about the, you know, the ecstasy of victory, and I know the sadness of defeat. So
Yes, you've been on both ends with this national team program, haven't you?
Yes, and you were there too in Hamilton, and it didn't feel very good, I can tell you that.
Bure takes it back into his own zone. The Soviets on the power play.
You'll notice it doesn't matter that they got a 7-2 lead. They're taking the big guys right out there right now, the big crews out there to get that puck.
Right now, it almost appears as though the Soviets are going to try and play a game with that puck. Try and keep it away from the Canadian team as Sheldon Kennedy comes in, falls, knocked off the puck by Malika. Mogilny has it, then loses it. The Soviets get it back. It comes out into the center ice area, but the Canadian defenseman Jeff Smith recovers. Now the Soviets are going to take it back into their own zone. They're just going to try and kill off time.
It's the old basketball stall that they're using, and the fans aren't very happy about it.
Sheldon Kennedy took a shot. Bryn DeMuro was in front of the net. He couldn't get a stick on it. Mogilny is standing all by himself down at the Canadian blue line, looking for that puck. Couldn't get to it as Bayou goes back after it. 1:20 remaining in the game, 40 seconds remaining in the penalty. And again, the Soviets take the puck back into their own zone. They're not trying to do anything at all with this man advantage.
Everybody is just taking open ice, as we call it. Keep the puck, don't let them touch it. It's just kind of the old keep away, you know, the old keep away we used to play as kids. And that's all they're doing is spread out over the ice. They said, hey, there's only 54 seconds left. We're not going to let them touch the puck. We got the man advantage.
And they've been doing a rather effective job of just that. Fedorov plays it back into his own zone. 42 seconds remaining. The Canadian penalty is over. The Soviets, for the first time, move it ahead. Khristich, as the Canadian team is back at full strength, takes the hit from Racine, and the puck slides down into Canadian territory. It's offside.
Well, 33 seconds. I'm sorry, I can't agree with Stengel about it isn't over till it's over, because it's over before it's over tonight when you got a 7-2 lead. The Canadians got to say, hey, that's, we've given it our best shot now. Let's get the game over here. I've often felt when you're on a losing score, let's get the game over so you can get it off the score clock and we don't have to watch the score anymore. But that's realistic. The Czechs have now won 7-2, so you know where that puts them when it comes to medal competition, right into the bronze. And of course the Soviets get the gold for again, and that means we will listen and attentively listen to their national anthem at another world tournament.
Well, it's interesting that the two teams that were battling for a medal tonight, Canada trying to win the silver, Czechoslovakia the bronze, should wind up with identical 7-2 scores, except Czechoslovakia won, Canada lost.
Well, you know, I used to say one of our themes when I was managing the team, as you know, they play the national anthem for the winning team. And I remember when you were over there with us in Finland, our theme was that we aren't going to hear the Soviet national anthem tonight. Well, I'm afraid that doesn't apply here.
Udin takes a hit and along the boards, it's fired down into Canadian territory for an icing call against the Soviet Union.
Well, we're 20 seconds away from not only the end of the game, but the end of the tournament. And the best thing they have to say here now is that, and it certainly says on the face of these young men as we see the Canadian bench, they know what it's all about. They don't feel any better about it than anybody else, worse than anybody. They give what they gave what they had, and that's got, you know, you got to respect that. They certainly gave everything they got.
One of the interesting things about the four games on this final day of the tournament was that every game meant something. Even the contest between the two teams that had yet to win. The end result was that Norway remains in A pool and West Germany is relegated to B pool. And that's the end of the hockey game. Sidorov picks up the puck and the Soviet team moves out to celebrate, throwing sticks and gloves high into the air as the Soviet Union was deprived of a gold medal last year on home ice when the tournament was held in Moscow. And they come through here in Anchorage, Alaska, defeating Canada by a score of 7-2 to capture the gold medal. The Soviets with just one blemish on their record. That was a 5-3 setback to Czechoslovakia. And Robert Chernikov, the Soviet coach,
is lifted high into the air by his jubilant players. The Soviet Union, for the eighth time, World Junior Hockey Champions.
Well, it tells you, Don, as we talked before, I've been there. I know what it's like to win that gold in international competition. And I know they like beating the Canadians as much as we like beating the Soviets. That's what makes a competition like this so interesting, Don, is that it doesn't matter what's at stake. When the Canucks meet the Soviets, there's lots of emotion, lots of feeling, and both sides love to beat the other side.
Mogilny with three goals, the scoring star of this game for the Soviet squad.
And give them credit, they're a heck of a hockey team. I mean, they lost the one game in this competition to a good fired up Czech team, but they played very, very well. There is a lot of talent. They play very well as a team.
So the Soviet Union, for the eighth time, is World Junior Champions, and we'll hear the Soviet national anthem. Competition, we hear the shortened version of the Soviet national anthem. This time we got the full treatment. The Soviet Union winning the gold medal with a 7-2 victory over Canada. We'll return for our wrap-up from Anchorage after this.